Texas. what town?
Well, it was out on a farm. It wasn't any special town.
Uh-huh.
Well,
what part of Texas was that in?
Well, that part was in Brownwood. Brownwood City, close to, and Rising Star, whatever county that is. They used to have different counties.
Yeah.
Excuse me, folks. I get frog, you know. Grandma. well, I'll start. I'll finish about my parents getting married. They wanted to get married on Christmas Day, or close to Christmas now. I don't remember. It wasn't Christmas Day. So they had. What Dad had, he had the buggy and then the horse pulling buggy. He picked my mother up and was going to go to, what they, I don't know what they call them, where they get married. Not in the church. Because he was that kind
of... Justice of the Peace?
Yeah, something like that. But I don't remember. If I had the story, then I could read it to you. But, so they were going to stay in the buggy and have the minister or whoever it is to come out and marry them in the buggy. Well, let's see what happened now. Anyway, they got married.
Well, that's the main thing, I guess.
Yeah.
And
well,
when was that?
Well, they were married in 1905 in December, and then they had a house, a home already prepared, so Dad took his bride to the home, and then he would work on the farms, and Mom would help in the field. I don't know what they... It was cotton and peanuts.
And this was not their farm, then?
No, they were just renting. Or sharing, I guess they call it sharing. They would make a farm. They would make produce and then share it with the owner. And
it was important for them to do their part of the field, though. They had a certain designated part of the field?
Yes.
They just didn't help with all the fields. They just had their one.
Just a section.
I see.
Certain section. Certain farm. A little house on it. And,
so was that where your brother was born then? Your oldest brother?
Well, my brother was born 1907 in July 1st, 10th. July 10th. In Nolan County. I don't know if you have to get a map and they'll find out where Nolan County is.
And that
is.
Was still out in the field.
That was in the field.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, out on the farm.
Mm-hmm.
And then they moved. I don't know how old he was when they moved from there to another place. And then in 1908, in November 12th, I was born. In Brown County, the counties came like this, Brown County and Eastland County, and so I was born in the corner of Brown County, close to Eastland.
That's interesting that you would be born in Brown County and marry a Brown,
yes.
Isn't it?
Well, that's just, you know, names, what's the name anyway?
Yeah. How many months were you apart from... Uncle Raymond?
My brother was 16 months old. Well, 16 months old.
Uh-huh.
From July to November.
Yeah.
12, a year, and then 12 months, and then 4 months.
Yeah.
And 16.
So did they stay in Texas the whole time, or?
No, they moved again. Dad found a place where... Opal was
tell that watermelon story? What happened to that crop of watermelons?
Well, this was when Dad wanted to sell the watermelon so that we could go to California. Well, this was after Pearl, Nathan was born, and after Pearl was born, and of course the youngest girl was born in California. Ruth.
Mm-hmm. So how old were you when the watermelon story took place?
Well, I was six, and in November when we got train tickets, I had my birthday on the 12th of November, and then we got on the train, and my sister Opal was 16. Five years old. And then she had her birthday when we were on the train. And we came out to Southern California.
Okay.
Alhambra. Hmm?
First tell them about the watermelon story. What happened to the watermelon?
Well, I don't know, but that's very interesting.
Oh, that's one of my favorite stories. I've always loved
it. Well, let's see, I'm getting too mixed up here.
Yeah.
Well, Dad had a big wagon. And so he says, well, I can't sell them around here, so I'll just take them into town. The nearest town, I think, was Cisco or something. And he said, I'll try to sell them there. Well, he couldn't sell them because everybody had raised watermelons that year. And so finally he ended up giving them away, most of them. Those who, you know, didn't have any, couldn't afford to buy any. So he did bring some home again and gave them to the pigs.
I hear that you would go out in the fields and just eat the hearts out, is that what you said?
Well, that was before he
took them to town. And you knew that he wouldn't be able to sell them all, so what did you and the kids do?
Well, we went out and we'd dump the watermelon, see if it was ripe, and we'd split it open and then just eat the heart out. Well, you know how kids are.
And you had watermelon tonight. That's how much
yeah.
You still like it.
Oh, I still like watermelon, if they're good. I don't like the watermelons that taste like citrus or,
That you still
right.
have to know just the right bump, huh? On the
well,
watermelon.
Sometimes, but you can make a mistake with the thumb.
Yeah, sometimes it's overripe, isn't it?
Yeah, right.
Well, we got on the train in Texas.
Well, on the train.
Mm-hmm.
On the train, see, my Pearl was, 3 months old? No, she was born in October. And we left in November, so she's only about 6 weeks old.
Oh, my.
And so, Mom, of course, had a seat alone so that she could have the baby over on the one side, and she was on this side. And then right across, there was a seat for Nathan, who was, you know, just 3 years old. And, let's see, Nathan was, he was born in October, so he was 3 in October. Because he was little anyway, so she made a pallet on that seat for him. And then Mom got so tired that she went to sleep, and the rest of the kids were sitting on the seat behind her. And so she went to sleep, and Pearl fell off the seat. And then when Mom woke up, she said, "Where's Pearl? Where's Pearl? Somebody stole her," you know. And so that woke us kids up, the rest of us kids. And so we said, "Well, Mama,
Mm-hmm.
That was the last picnic my mother took us to. Then shortly after that, well, let's see. No, we were still in Alhambra somewhere, I don't know, on 6th Street something. And Raymond and I started school, and we were in the same grade. First, and well, we were, while we were in Texas, we went to what they call a primer, or primer, or whatever, primer. But then in Alhambra, we went to the first grade.
So how old were you two when you went to the first grade?
Well, he was about the same age as him, 10 or 8, or 8 and a half. But there was something that Mom didn't like. She taught us different things, and she wouldn't let us go to any dances or anything like that, in Texas. And so when we started school, we were quite musical anyway, because Dad always taught us school, our songs. And when we got to school, they were playing, I guess this is what's called?
Record
yeah.
player. Mm-hmm.
And then they had a maypole.
Oh, yeah.
And they go take a string or a cord or whatever it is, go around, and we danced along there. I didn't think it was dancing at all. I was just having lots of fun.
Mm-hmm.
But then when we told Mother about it, well, she went right down there and to school. She says, I don't want my daughter and my son to do that anymore. And so the teacher wanted to know why. Because that's dancing and we don't believe in it. And so, of course, we were disappointed because I liked it. But anyway, we didn't have to do it. They wouldn't let us. We just had to sit and watch. So that was kind of, we couldn't understand, we were not old enough to understand why. But, but of course, we had to obey Mom. Then my dad's sister and her husband moved down to Blythe, California then, and to pick cotton. And so she persuaded Dad to come down there. So then we all moved down to Blythe. Hot country, the sand.
That's close to the desert, or is in the desert?
Well, Blythe, where Blythe is.
Not real sure.
Well, it's in the desert, all right.
Mm-hmm.
So, so Aunt Doshia didn't have room for us to stay, and so we put up a tent to live in for a while. Then I have some pictures. Opal, my sister, sent me pictures of me standing in front of the tent. And I was dressed up like I was going to Sunday school. And I didn't remember having those good of clothes, But my mom still had the sewing machine. She had a sewing machine, and she did all the sewing. So I don't know if she, either she made that dress or somebody else gave it to me. I don't know. But anyway, long story.
Yeah, so you went to the... You lived in a tent about how long, and then you moved somewhere else, I suppose?
Well, not very long, because Dad found a adobe house.
Ooh.
And we didn't know that it leaked. When it rained, it just leaked like a sieve. So Dad had to go up and fix the roof. And then we had the wood stove they had to cook on. Well, I don't like to think about all those days.
It wasn't your favorite days then?
No. We made some friends with some people's names for fools. And I had a girlfriend, and
we call them now.
Yeah,
yeah.
The stays all around, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, as Mom says, well, we're going to go to Texas, and I'm going to do all the driving. And then, you know, they had the crank with the crank.
Oh, yeah, on the front.
And so, Mom was pretty strong. And she did the starting of the car, driving. And it took us 10 days to come, go from Blythe to Texas, to California. Texas, yeah. Blythe, California, to Texas. Let's see, where did... Oh, her folks lived then at, in Garland, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And so, or maybe we went to his mother's place. His mother had 60 acres in, down in near Pioneer. I think we went, that's where we went first, because his mother was getting blind, couldn't see very good. And
how old were you then when you went to back to Texas?
Well, let's see, I was, I wasn't 12. No, it's just
10 or 11.
11.
Huh?
11.
11.
11. Let's see, it was in the summertime. I mean,
hot across that desert then.
Yeah.
Wow.
But anyway, Mom was a good driver. And we went up through Utah. And Mom had heard many stories about the Mormons.
Uh-huh.
And so, she, you know, we didn't have much room in the car. We had bedding on the, Mom made it just a bit clear from the back seat to the front seat. And four of us had to sleep on that.
Uh-huh.
And whenever we want, anybody want to turn over, everybody had to turn over. And because the four of us, you know, laying on there, and then Dad had Pearl, the youngest one, up in front. He was hauling her most of the time.
And he still wasn't feeling good.
He wasn't feeling very good. When we got to Grandma, we still had to, we had to put up a tent until we found the place.
That was Grandma Bishop?
Mm-hmm, Grandma Bishop.
Uh-huh.
And,
when you went back
That's
to
right.
Texas.
Uh-huh.
You took that same tent that you had at Blythe then?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
We had the tent in case we had to stop somewhere on the way, you know, pitch a tent, sleep in.
Mm-hmm.
Is that on now?
Mm-hmm.
Well, hi again.
We took a break.
Yeah. Well, anyway, my grandmother and my grandfather passed away when I was 2 years old. Well, I don't remember seeing him. But my grandmother and, I think there were four sons living with him at that. All the girls were married.
This was the bishops.
Bishops, yeah. And Uncle Mac was the youngest of my grandma. Grandma had 14 children living, and Uncle Mac was the youngest. Then there were twins 2 years before that. One was the girl and a boy. Mary. Oh, some boy thing. Well, anyway.
You must have liked Mary a little better.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm just going backwards. I should start at the top again.
Well, you were just telling us about the four at home when you got back to Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And you played with them, I suppose. Or
no.
Were they older? They were like teenagers? Or
except Mac. Mac and Mac was, I think, old. My husband was. So I
oh,
was Wedding. they're called all of James Jim. So anyway, my mother always spoke up when they said Jimerson, because we're not Jimerson, we're Jamerson.
Yeah. Now, did you get to go to school while you were in Blythe or at your grandma Bishop's or grandma Jamerson's house?
No.
Didn't get to go to school at all?
No. Not until we moved from that place. Dad found a farm where he could rent or to work at shares again.
Mm-hmm.
And so we moved. Let's see, where was that? I don't remember what county.
But it was in Texas still.
In Texas. So Dad had, well, he worked for a man who was grouchy. I didn't like him. Nobody liked him. And he knew it. And so, anyway, he told my dad we had to buy stuff on time because we didn't have any money. Yeah. Because Dad had spent it all. And then Dad got better, so he didn't get work. And it was through prayer that he got well of that. And so Mom was a good prayer warner.
And were you going to church at that time also, and the people
well,
praying there at church?
Well, we tried to. No, we weren't. No, we didn't have any church then.
Being out
but
in the farm fields.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Stuff, so.
Well, let's see. What I was starting to say now.
Okay, you went. Your dad got a share crop again.
Oh, yes, uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
And this man says, work more and eat less. When we had to borrow to buy things on time.
Mm-hmm.
And so that, well, Mom finally got situated so that she could raise a garden and chickens. So the next year, Dad had a farm, and he shared that with, let's see, cotton. I guess it was cotton. Mostly cotton in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And peanuts. But no, they weren't raising peanuts there because there was no sandy enough ground.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway,
I bet you picked your share.
Oh yeah, we had to pick cotton. Well, first we had to weed it, you know, hoe it, thin it out, so that when they plant the seeds, you know, they just plant a whole row.
Mm-hmm.
And they all grow up, and it's too close together, so you have to cut it and have to
thin it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Hoe it out, they call it. So we kids had our share on that. Except for the little ones.
Yeah.
And then we wanted to go to school, and school was about, I think it's 2 miles, mile and a half or 2 miles to walk, and we'd have to go through pastures and climb fences or go on down the fence.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was just a two-room schoolhouse, and I don't think we made any grades because we kept moving around so much, you know. And then we'd have to get off whenever the crops were ready to harvest. Well, we had to quit school and help with the harvest.
Were you able to read by then?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. You learned to read in first grade?
And we learned to read in California.
Good.
Well, in fact, we were in the third grade when we went back to Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Then we just went to school about 4 months or 6 months out of the year, depending on
finished with that crop of cotton, did you stay there several years then at that place?
Well, no. That's when Dad wanted to go back to California. And of course Mom didn't want to.
She liked being close to her family, of course.
But of course we made pretty good on cotton. And so Dad took the money that he got on that and we went back to Texas. I mean to California.
How old were you then? You were more than 12, though.
Oh, yeah. I turned 12 while we were on that farm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 12. And the crop was in August. Then we got to, what did we go?
And so when did you move to Redlands?
Oh, well, we went down to Blythe, and we started the school down there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went, Dad said we wanted to go to, he said some other city, but, well, Redlands, I think, I don't know where.
But anyway,
he
you ended up
following. He's just kind of following his sisters.
Uh-huh. Did they finally move
Nancy,
to Redlands then?
Aunt Nancy, that's the oldest sister at that time,
mm-hmm.
was living in California at the Turlock. No, not Turlock. Fresno.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't. We went up to see her, but we didn't. Like that place up there, so we went to Redlands.
How old were you when you moved to Redlands, do you remember? You were a teenager.
1921 or 2 when we moved to Redlands. 21, I think. So I was born in 1980. Figured out. So anyway.
And so you spent your teenage years in Redlands.
Yes.
And you discovered a tent meeting that was going on, I remember you telling me.
We were living on Colton. Colton's where we had that. They had that tent meeting.
That's okay.
Columbia Street.
Uh-huh.
We were living on Columbia Street. And that was about 4 blocks from Colton down north. And so we heard about this. Well, first there was a holiness, just plain holiness church, holding meetings just before, about 2 blocks from our house, and then 2 blocks down from Colton. So we got started there first.
Now, is this your whole family?
No, just girls, just teenagers, just my brother and I, and my sister.
Mm-hmm.
Mom, of course, worked. She finally got a job in packing oranges. And Dad, carpentry or something. Of course, later, he got a job in Santa Fe shops. But that wasn't at this time.
So you went to this special service. You went to this Holiness Church,
Holiness
but then
Church,
you
yeah.
heard about.
Then
okay.
then the Free Methodists brought their tent and put it up on Colton and Columbia,
mm-hmm.
the corner. And so we were all excited about a big tent like that,
liked the music there. It was a little more up to date, I think you said, or something.
The old hymn wasn't up to date. It was well up to date at that time.
Yeah.
And then we had two weeks meeting, both on the last 2 weeks, but it lasted 6 weeks.
Mm.
6 weeks, and we had a different minister to come in. Claude Watson was the one who started it.
Oh, is that right?
And I got acquainted with him then,
uh-huh.
But I never thought about working for him.
Well, of course. You were only how old? In your teenage years still.
Yeah, I was a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was, I don't know, I can figure out that later on, but anybody interested, well, you can do that.
Yeah.
I too.
Now, I hear you got into the depression, or close to it anyway, and you had to quit school. You didn't get to finish high school right away.
What is that?
Or maybe it was because, no, it was before the depression, wasn't it? It was when Grandma had her last baby, and you had to go to work. Was that when you quit high school?
That's when I quit. To Pat Garnish.
I hear you.
Pat Garnish for 4 years. And then I heard about Los Angeles Pacific College. And so then I inquired about it. I could get a job in a home, pay for my board and room, and then my tuition, I could work there for school for some of it. But then I had saved up some from packing on this. Well, before I went to Los Angeles Pacific College, I had a car, and I drove back from between Redlands, from Redlands to San Bernardino, and went to business college. And they were supposed to get me a job, but then I decided, well, I want to go to Los Angeles Pacific College. So I didn't get my certificate from that business college, but I got my training. And so then I got a home, I got work in a home. We had three children. And I was supposed to, after school, be there and look after them and do the laundry and cleaning of the house, because both the mother and the father worked. And so while I was there, their girl got diphtheria.
Oh, diphtheria?
No. Well, some kind of disease. And so I had to go home and quarantine for a week. Because I slept with her.
Sounded like smallpox. They did a lot of
smallpox.
No?
Wasn't diphtheria either, but it was some kind of...
They need to do that a little more often now, don't they? They don't have that sort of thing.
So I was out. I stayed home, and I didn't get it. So then when I came back, I got another place to stay for a while. And then finally, I got a job at the college.
Now, were you in college or high school at the time?
I had finished my high school, 3 years of high school. Then I got a job at the college and was living with the pastor and their wife was at Herman Free Methodist Church. And
what was their name, do you remember?
French.
Oh.
Reverend and Mrs. French, and they had one son. just a little boy. So then when he had the mumps, I slept downstairs and he slept upstairs. I never did get it, but I missed that, didn't have the mumps, but I didn't miss in school.
So what year did you graduate from high school?
1933.
Okay, and then started right into the college the next semester.
Well, I was working,
And you were you working for Claude Watson by then?
No.
Not yet.
No.
Okay.
I was still working at school.
What type of work
as
did you do?
As a bookkeeper.
Oh, a bookkeeper.
Yeah, I went to that business college and I learned how to do books. But there were other things that connected with the what the business education is. So I really passed on the bookkeeping part.
Great.
So maybe have them give me another break.
Okay. This is where Mrs. Watson lives. She will be 104 next month. And here's Grandma holding some pretty flowers that we're going to give to her. This is our house that we lived in when Ron came a-courtin'. And this is Mrs. Cornell's house that I cleaned while I was in church in LAPC. And here's the lady of the house. At 649 Avenue 6. There is our house way down there. We're up on the LAPC campus. Turning. This is where our apartment building was. I could literally see my mom and dad's house from our apartment. That has been torn down. Looks like a mechanical shop or something. They put bleachers over there where our apartment was. And they're fixing this area, I hope, down below. Go ahead. That's the old building that we remember, right? It says, now it says...
That's the new building. This is old.
Okay.
That's the old.
This says...
Dormitory down there.
Pacific Christian High School.
Mm-hmm.
And they've kept up the lawn nice. John Marshall Junior High School. And we're on the the corner of Sierra Bonita and Casa Grande Street. We'll be turning up here and going to Grandma's. This was our house on Oxford. And across the street was my girlfriend's house, Sharon, right there. We used to play baseball in the street. There is 1169 North Sierra Bonita. Came on. Well, Mom, here we are on the second day, and we're going to try to go on with a little bit more of your story. So, we ended up with high school, and so after high school was over, what happened then? After you finished high school. This is your story.
Well, I went to Los Angeles Pacific College in the first year of college, and then I had to work too for my way through. Then in the second year, I started the second year, and since Los Angeles Pacific College only had 2 years of college, I was a senior, counted as a senior, and we could go on the skip day.
Ooh.
Because we were seniors. Well, I went, got in with a group, and our seniors went up to Big Bear. When we got up there, we had started preparing meal for the evening, and we were going to stay all night up there in the cabin. So when it was before, still light outside, someone says, well, let's go toboggan. And my girlfriend, Rispa Lee, said, come on, Cora, let's get on the toboggan. It only held three people. And I said, well, I don't know how to ride the toboggan. And she said, oh, come on. She says, Louis Hart will be the guide, will guide us, and start it and so forth. So I said, well, you get on next to him, and I'll get on last. And so we did. We started down. We did good going down on the slide. But when we came to the end of the slide, it made us go way up high. And then when we hit the ground, there wasn't very much snow, and it had been packed by people walking across it.
Mm-hmm.
So we started to bump. And I sat down real hard. I held on to the ropes, and when I sat down, I felt my back hurt. And so I said, oh, Lord, help me hang on until we stop. stopped while I just collapsed and back, and everybody started running. Said, Coral, what's the matter with you? Get up. We're there. And I said, don't touch me. I said, it's my back. And so then they did lift me and put me on the sled more easily and took me up the hill. We were down in the gully, like, mm-hmm. Took me up, carried me out on the sled up to, well, there was a little kind of a town or something there.
Mm-hmm.
And we thought, they said, well, we better take you to the doctor then, see if we can find the doctor. So there was a doctor upstairs. Well, they couldn't carry the sled up there, so they fixed their hands like this. Two men fixed their hands like this, and I sat on their hands and put my hands on their shoulders. And they carried me up the hill, up the stairs. And it was quite a few stairs. When we got up there, well, the doctor examined me, and I was about faint, almost faint. So he says, here, when I start talking, I have to cough.
Yeah.
Excuse me. So anyway, he says, well, your back is sprained very badly. And he said, and there isn't any ambulance up here to take you down to San Bernardino. And so Louis says, well, I can take her down and in my car. And so I said, well, whatever. And I was just committed to the Lord. I just said, Lord, take over. Because I foolishly got on that sled. But anyway, so they put me, he taped my back, all my back, so it wouldn't move too much. And then they set me in the front. It's just a coupe, just one-seated, and
mm-hmm.
with a thing on,
right.
On the back. And put pillows around me and under my arms. And so wasn't any seat belts. So we were going down the hill, and he would go around this curve pretty fast. Oh, I said, Louis, be careful. You sling me around. It hurts my back. me on a